come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Sowing in the sunshine, sowing in the shadows, fearing neither clouds nor winter's chilling breeze. By and by the harvest and the labor ended, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Talbot Park Baptist Church. Good to see everybody here. Last Sunday of summer.
Oh, right?
Yeah. But the good news is football's back. Mixed reactions on that one. Let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you.
Please join with me in the call to worship. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is mature, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse people made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth comes a blessing and a cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Amen. Please stand as you're able as we sing our praise song, 10,000 Reasons.
Worship is all.
may be seated. As we go into our time of prayer, I know some of you have heard this news already, but I just want to make you aware that Ron Cooper died yesterday morning, and we want to lift up the family. I'm glad you're here with us, because you know everybody in here is surrounding you with their arms right now and lifting you up in prayer. So let's go to the Lord in prayer together. God, as we come to you this morning, we do so in awe and wonder at who you are and how you work in our lives. We come to you full of joy at the good things and blessings we have experienced. We come to you with heavy hearts in the midst of our grief and loss. And God, all of it, every single bit of it, you have created and offered us in the fullness of what it means to live in this earth. Some of it is good, some of it is very difficult. But we thank you that in the midst of all of it, we find you and we are drawn closer to you and to each other. When times are good and we celebrate, and we come here this morning in part to say thank you, to say thank you for those blessings, to lift our voices in song and in prayer and in praise for how you continue to fill us with life and goodness and hope. And God, this morning we also acknowledge that we are broken in many ways beyond repair, that we make mistakes, that we fall, we fail, we experience loss and regret, and God, in the midst of all that, we need forgiveness, and we find grace because of who you are, because of your love and your life moving in our midst. God, we are thankful for this community of Talbot Park, for this people we have to be shaped around your son, Jesus, to learn and to grow together as we seek to follow him. And God, we know that there is much that is happening in our world. We lift up our prayers today for those who are hurting in this community, in this city, and around the world. We're in places of war and poverty and disease. People who experience things that we cannot even imagine. And God, we seek, even in the midst of all that, to continue to proclaim that you are working for the good of this world to redeem all those, and you have sent your son because your heart is broken as well over the way this world continues to suffer. And that even now, even as a part of this worship experience, your spirit is moving in us, through us, around us, working to bring redemption and joy to all creation. That is something worth celebrating today. We thank you for that promise, that hope that we find. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Good morning. Our scripture this morning is from Mark chapter 8, verses 27 to 38. Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Peter answered, "You are the Messiah." Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but the concerns of man." Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes to his Father's glory with the holy angels." The word of God for the people of God. Everyone who is able, please stand and sing hymn 469.
Month of September, we're looking at the wisdom literature of the Bible, which It's how we group it. In the Jewish Bible, they have three main sections: the Torah, first five books of the Bible, then the prophets, and then what they call the writings. Everything else just gets clumped together at the end. And this is one of those books that often gets clumped in that section. It's Ecclesiastes, and I'm going to read the entire second chapter of Ecclesiastes, beginning in verse 1. I said to myself, come now, I will make a test of pleasure, enjoy yourself. But again, this also was vanity. I said of laughter, it is mad, and of pleasure, what use is it? I searched with my mind how to cheer my body with wine, my mind still guiding me with wisdom, and how to lay hold on folly until I might see what was good for mortals to do under heaven during the few days of their life. I made great works. I built houses and planted vineyards for myself. I made myself gardens and parks and planted in them all kinds of fruit trees. I made myself pools from which to water the forest of growing trees. I bought male and female slaves and had slaves who were born in my house. I also had great possessions of herds and flocks, more than any who had been before me in Jerusalem. I also gathered for myself silver and gold and the treasure of kings and of the provinces. I got singers, both men and women, and delights of the flesh, and many concubines. So I became great and surpassed all who were before me in Jerusalem. Also my wisdom remained with me. Whatever my eyes desired, I did not keep from them. I kept my heart from no pleasure, for my heart found pleasure in all my toil, and this was my reward for all my toil. Then I considered all that my hands had done, the toil I had spent in doing it, and again, all was vanity, a chasing after wind. There was nothing to be gained under the sun. So I turned to consider wisdom and madness and folly, for what can the one do who comes after the king? Only what has already been done. Then I saw that wisdom excels folly as light excels darkness. The wise have eyes in their head, but fools walk in darkness. Yet I perceived that the same fate befalls all of them. Then I said to myself, what happens to the fool will happen to me also. Why then have I been so very wise? And I said to myself that this also is vanity. For there is no enduring remembrance of the wise or of fools, seeing that in the days to come all will have long been forgotten. How can the wise die just like fools? So I hated life, because what is done under the sun was grievous to me, for all is vanity and a chasing after wind. I hated all my toil in which I had toiled under the sun, seeing that I must leave it to those who come after me, and who knows whether they will be wise or foolish. Yet they will be master of all for which I have toiled and used my wisdom under the sun. This also is vanity. So I turned and gave my heart up to despair concerning all the toil of my labors under the sun, because sometimes one who has toiled with wisdom and knowledge and skill must leave it all to be enjoyed by another who did not toil for it. This also is vanity and a great evil. What do mortals get from all the toil and strain with which they toil under the sun? For all their days are full of pain. Their work is a vexation. Even at night, their minds do not rest. This also is vanity. There is nothing better for mortals than to eat and drink and find enjoyment in their toil. This also I saw is from the hand of God, for apart from him, who can eat and who can find enjoyment? For to the one who pleases him, God gives wisdom and knowledge and joy, but to the sinner, he gives the work of gathering and heaping, only to give to one who pleases God. This also is vanity and a chasing after wind. The word of God for the people of God. This morning, you are in luck, because your young, hip pastor is going to teach you the latest lingo so that you too will know how to communicate with the youth of today. You know, every generation has their own unique way of speaking. For some of you, that meant saying swell and neato. And then in the 1960s and 70s, everything was cool. That's cool, man. That's cool, dude. People my age used to say, that's radical. And then there are the youth of today. And of course, I was lying a minute ago when I told you I was hip. Just the fact that I use that word should be some indication that I'm totally out of touch. I'm probably the least cool 45-year-old I know. and I have no idea about contemporary slang, but I have children. And so I know, for example, that to say someone is riz is a good thing, because that means they have charisma, riz, R-I-Z-Z. And if something is really, really good, then you would say, that slays. Not like Santa slay, but like S-L-A-Y, that slays, that kills. Like Ellie will say about my sermon later today, that slayed, Dad. She's shaking her head, no. I'm getting it all wrong. All right, then there's the text abbreviation we have for our sermon today, F-O-M-O, FOMO, the fear of missing out. Have y'all heard this one? Yeah. Online dictionary defines FOMO as the fear of not being included in something, such as an interesting or enjoyable activity that others are experiencing. In other words, FOMO is when we worry about being left out of something good. And I know a lot of people who have FOMO. These are the kind of people who have a hard time deciding where they want to go out to eat, right? Because if they choose Mexican, well, maybe the surf rider would have been better. But if they choose the surf rider, maybe it would have been margarita night at Plaza Azteca. Y'all know people like this? These are the kind of people who never sign up for any of our church activities because they say, well, if I put my name down on the list, something might happen. I won't be able to do it. That's FOMO. You know, we got people who apply for jobs all the time up here at the church preschool. They come in, they've had 47 different jobs in the last 6 months on their resume. And you ask them about it, and they say, well, you know, that first job, I wasn't really wild about that. And then the second job had better benefits, but then there was this other job, and I wanted to see about that. And then my friend was working in this fourth job, and so I went over there. And you're like, just make up your mind already, right? But in our world, that is very hard to do because we have so many choices. And we are afraid if we commit to one thing, we're going to miss out on something else. You know, if we start dating this person, what if somebody better comes along? If we commit to this church, what if I find a better church next week? It's a FOMO. And it's the perfect abbreviation for our text today because Ecclesiastes is all about the fear of missing out. Vanity of vanities. All is vanity. In the King James Version, that's how the book of Ecclesiastes starts, but I prefer the Jewish translation, which says, utter futility. It's all futile. Sounds like a good beach read, doesn't it? No! There is a reason that I don't often preach from Ecclesiastes, because it's one of the bleakest books of the Bible. Ecclesiastes is so difficult that for centuries, rabbis and theologians debated over whether it should even be included in the pages of Scripture. And the overarching theme of Ecclesiastes is the meaninglessness of life. It's not light and fluffy, but I think there's some worthwhile wisdom here for us. So this morning we're going to dive right in, and I promise you it's going to slay. Ecclesiastes is authored by an anonymous teacher who over the years has often been suggested to be King Solomon, but the exact identity is unimportant. What we need to know for our purposes this morning is that this teacher has almost unlimited power and resources, which means they can do whatever they want. And in this second chapter of Ecclesiastes, that's exactly what they do. Teacher has FOMO, the fear of missing out. He wants to live his best life now. And so one by one, the teacher goes down the list to sample all the different things that promise to give our life meaning. First and most obviously, pleasure. Pleasure. Now that is a word that covers a lot of territory, right? Pleasure. Pleasure could mean sex, could mean food, definitely means partying, getting drunk. Even today when people say, I want to have a good time, what they usually mean is, I want to get drunk, want to get high, want to have sex. Instant gratification has always been, will always be, the easiest way for humans to forget their troubles for a little while. And so the teacher says, let's try it. Bring it on. Bring on the wine. Bring on the women. The text says the teacher builds vineyards, delights in the pleasures of the flesh. We know from the pages of Scripture, old King Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines. So this guy knows what he's talking about. He's tried it all. And then in verse 2, he says, what use is it? Now, personally, I would, before we rush to judgment, just like to try this experiment for myself, just to make sure he didn't miss anything, you know? But I suppose we could take the teacher's word for it. And many people in our world have had this experience of waking up after being drunk or being high or having sex with some stranger. And even though it felt pretty good at the time, later on, it does not feel so good. One of the ironies of life that the teacher in Ecclesiastes understands is that the more you and I engage in meaningless pleasure, the worse we feel. David Brooks recently wrote that the problem with our culture today is not too much desire, but the miniaturization of desire, that we settle for these small short-term hits, which I love, because I think that's absolutely right, that most of the time, it's not that you and I want too much. Is that the things we do want are so petty compared to a truly abundant life. Is pleasure bad? Of course not. I just preached an entire sermon last week on how laughter and good humor is good for life. So I don't think that pleasure is inherently bad. I don't think that sex or alcohol or entertainment is inherently evil. But I think when we chase after that stuff as ends unto themselves, when we use that stuff to dull us from reality, then life becomes empty and all we're doing is running after that next dopamine hit to keep the rush. It's not enough. And the teacher here in this passage of Scripture knows it, so he turns to the next thing that promises us happiness in life. Money. Text says the teacher builds gardens, pools. He has servants who wait on him hand and foot. He has tons of possessions, piles of gold. And maybe you and I have not had that particular experience, but let's be honest, we've thought about it, right? If I could just win the lottery. How many of us in here have wondered about that, and probably a couple times just since we've been sitting here this morning? Maybe we don't have a big pile of cash, although if you do, find those offering envelopes, okay? Slide a little bit of it in there. But even if we don't, even if we're not rich, you and I still use stuff, possessions, money, as a way for us to fill the emptiness of our lives. That's why we like Christmas so much, right? Because we like getting stuff. And that stuff, the kind of clothes we wear, the kind of car we drive, the kind of house we live in, that has come to define who we are. Molly and I watch a lot of HGTV. And I like it, but none of the shows on that channel are about providing housing for people. It's about wish fulfillment, right? Because when it comes down to it, you and I don't really need a whole lot. We need a roof over our heads. Running water is pretty good. Maybe a few windows. But on HGTV, they go way beyond that because they got granite countertops. They got stainless steel appliances. They got always an open floor plan. I hate open floor plan. Everybody loves open floor plan. Three-car garage. And the realtor, without fail, will say to the client, you deserve this. That's what you and I have come to believe. We deserve it. We think we need all that stuff to have a good life. That's why you and I will never hear a politician, never hear a politician of either party say to us, forget about the economy. Y'all got enough already. No, nobody says that. They all say, vote for me and I'll make you richer. And we say, yeah. Because it's just assumed that more stuff, more money will make us happy. But the teacher says, no. Some of that stuff may provide comfort, but it's temporary because even the richest person still has problems. Even the wealthiest person still gets sad and lonely. It's not enough. And so the teacher turns to two more things that are often held up here in the church as solutions to what it looks like to have a good life: wisdom and hard work. And the teacher studies, and he learns, and he toils, and he labors, and at the end of the day he says, well, I got wiser, but I still died just like the fool does. And he said, I worked my butt off, but I still died just like the lazy person. And this is the existential problem of Ecclesiastes. Even when we do good things, we still die. What's the point? I think many people have that lurking in our subconscious, whether or not we say it out loud, but Ecclesiastes just names it. I think that's what makes this book so valuable. Because this teacher is willing to ask the question that we all ask: what gives life meaning? The answer comes in the final few verses of this passage, after the teacher has sampled everything life has to offer. He concludes that you and I cannot find joy apart from God. That the secret to a meaningful life, if we want to call it that, is not how much pleasure we experience, not how much money or stuff we have, not even how wise we are. You and I find purpose in what God gives us. And when we're focused on pleasing God, the enjoyment of everyday life becomes its own reward. Y'all hear me? I don't know if y'all were here about a month ago when we had a panel of young people speak during our Sunday school hour. I thought it was very good. But part of what came to light during that time was the fact that lots of young people today don't seem to care much about anything. It's not just that they don't care about the church. They don't really care about school, don't really care about work, even sports. There's this feeling of persistent nihilism. And I will tell you, that gives me chills. Because if nothing else, we as the people of God exist in this world to give voice to our belief that life matters. That we are created in the image of a good God and we are called to live out of that goodness. But I think there are so many, not just young people, lots of people in our world today who do not feel that sense of goodness that gives their life meaning. And so why not just sit around, play video games, stare at the wall all day if there's no purpose behind it? Even worse than the fear of missing out is the fear that there's nothing worth missing out on. And after years of COVID, all this political fighting, natural disasters, horrible things that happen every single day, I think that there are lots of people in our world who are just kind of shut down. And they don't care about anything anymore. Some of them may be sitting in the sanctuary this morning. And so I think these words from the teacher in Ecclesiastes are a vital reminder that even when life seems empty, you and I still find purpose in serving God. Are we still going to die? Yes, we are. But part of why life matters is because we want it to matter. There is holiness in our desire to create meaning, and we find meaning, we find joy in the way that we care for each other. I recently went to visit Ellen Turner, which is always a delight. Most of y'all know Ellen, one of our longtime members here, recently turned 95 years old. And while I was talking to her, she made the statement that she has had a good life. And I was thinking about that later, because Ellen Turner has never had a lot of money, never had a lot of stuff. She's never been famous. She's never gotten wild or crazy, at least not that I know of. But because of her faith, Ellen has found quiet satisfaction in her work, in her family, in her friends. And even though that may seem small and insignificant to others, that is what a good life looks like. And Ellen has the wisdom to know that. So often you and I express these regrets over what might have been, you know, FOMO. The teacher in Ecclesiastes urges us to think about what we do have and to commit to that life fully. So let's eat, drink, and be merry, and enjoy the fullness of the good life that we find together in the Lord. Amen. Let's pray together. God, there's a lot of other options out there. A lot of substitutes that are enticing. A lot of things that we think may offer us joy and meaning and purpose in life. And we're led astray all the time by those things, by those promises that we will be happy if only we had more money, if only we had this stuff, if only we were smarter, if only we worked harder. If only we could have a good time. And we tell ourselves these things, but ultimately these ancient words from the book of Ecclesiastes remind us of what we all know deep down inside, that none of that can replace or substitute for the truth and joy we find in knowing you. And God, without you, that stuff is meaningless, but with you, through you, because of you, we find purpose and meaning in all of those things. That because of you, you give our lives that fullness, and we are able to enjoy the good things that we experience. And we thank you. We thank you this morning for the good lives that you have given us. And even though it may not look that way to the world, we are grateful for the ways that you are creating within us life and goodness. We pray that in a world that has often given in to despair and believes that there is no hope, that we will continue to proclaim the good news of what it looks like to be filled with this joy of serving you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A passage that Kathleen read a little while ago always haunted me. That question that Jesus asked his disciples, still asking us today, what good is it if you got everything, everything in the world, but you forfeit your soul? What good is it if you have all the things that money can buy and all the pleasure we think we need and all the wisdom? Where is that going to get us without Christ? That remains the invitation for us this morning to recognize the true source of life and joy as we stand and sing hymn number 282.
That is true, striving. Please join me in prayer. As we present our offerings today, we are reminded of your great love for us. Your love knows no bounds and is beyond measure. Help us reflect your love in all that we do, including our giving. May these gifts be used to spread your love to others, bringing hope and healing to a world in need. Thank you for your love that never fails us. In Jesus' name, amen.
You may be seated. I want to thank you again for joining us today, those who are joining us online, and just a few reminders you will see there in the bulletin. Our Wednesday nights have resumed, so we meet at 5:30, bring your own dinner, and we're talking about the Ten Commandments. If you didn't come this last week, you missed the first commandment, no biggie. That's who you can overlook that one. 9 out of 10 is not bad, all right? So show up this week. We have a great time. Just hanging out, talking together. I hope you'll be a part of that. Book group is starting back, not this Tuesday, a week from Tuesday. So if you want to be part of that, let me know and I will order you a book. And then our own opportunity for indulgent pleasure is coming up Saturday, October 5th. Dinner and a concert. We're going to have heaven-bound gospel group singing here. And you see the menu there. Because if it just says TBD, I learned a long time ago, nobody signs up when it says TBD. You got to have the actual food on there before the people sign up for it, because they want to know, I'm not signing up until I know what I'm going to eat, because I know how y'all operate, right? So we got the menu on there. We know what we're having. Sign up on the sheet out there. It's going to be fun. Now, let's go out to live, to love, and to slay in the name of God. Amen.